and really in discovering the direction of the music for the director, working with the director before anyone else, he and the film editor.
Now, Brittany, you're relatively new in local music editing. How did you go into that world? You were a music coordinator for composer Christopher Leonard. So how did you enter that world?
I actually was a singer growing up, so I studied opera, and I knew I wanted to stay in the music world. Went to the Sundance Institute and found out about music editing there and just absolutely fell in love. I thought I was going to be some sort of a music manager or agent, and I found music editing, and that's what I wanted to do. So I moved out to LA and got the job with Chris and started doing music coordinating, and started doing music editing on the side. And then once I stopped working for Chris, I started doing music editing full time, which has been pretty fantastic.
All right, now let's go to the composer. So, in terms of you're coming on a project, when generally are you hired by the director? What's your relationship like with the music editor, music supervisor? Let's start with the director.
Director.
Sorry.
Usually we come on at the end when either they've run out of money and the film is pretty much complete. Because one of the frustrations of working in a project that's ongoing in terms of editorial, you can't really spend the time on details, which is one of the things that I love doing. And I've worked on scenes where I've been very proud of the scene, and I showed to the director, he said, "Oh, mate, no, that whole scene's gone now." So I now just write, I've learned my lesson. I write my ass off, no matter what it is. And then I leave it up to music editors to chop it all out and put it together so that at least my efforts are still safe and sound. And in places where, like Roger Donaldson, the director of the Bank Job, loves music throughout. Like I think the Bank Job had like two reels where there was 30 seconds without any music, and then it was like score for the rest of the film. So in places where there aren't music, and they're looking at those, they're at the top, which is putting all the elements together, as you heard, the music editor will then be asked to create a cue for a scene that I hadn't scored. And so that's the value of the great music editor, because especially if someone who has musical background can really put cues together, sometimes better than what I would have done, but using the material that I've already written. Mm-hmm. So occasionally I would never have come up with that. So thank you very much.
Well, I know, Kurt, you're also a composer, so you're given that assignment as a music editor. Yeah. When you're wearing a music editor hat. Yeah. Do you sometimes write the music then yourself, or?
Not generally when I'm the music editor on the film. I mean, there's a composer, and I think basically the answer is no to that. I mean, I try not to encroach my own skill or lack thereof in that direction when I'm hired as the music editor. I don't think that would really be the right thing to do, but.
But they do write.
We have a song.
I know, it's
not. I'm just saying, there's a director I worked with a few years ago. He's a terrific guy, and this was his next film, and he sent me the script, and I was inspired by the script, and I started writing a few ideas, and I thought, he'd be a great one to write the song with. We've known each other for many years, and I took these ideas over to his house. Should I talk about it now or not? It doesn't matter.
Let's get back to it. We're getting everything.
Yeah. Composing the music editing is really a separate thing. But yes, I compose when I have the opportunity.
All right, so now composer's hired, but music editor, supervisor. Orchestration, when does that come about? Who decides how many musicians are going to be used for the scoring session?
Up.
sounds to get an approximation of what it's going to sound like. And they don't necessarily know the idiosyncrasies of the orchestra if it's going to be an orchestral thing. And that's where the orchestra will step in and make those things play by the humans. So it's a little different in each situation depending on who the composer is. And it's become more so over the years. I'm old enough to remember when there were no computers and everything was written by hand. And in those days, you would start with a sketch, and some people, their sketches were more complete than others, that they might just have a four-line sketch. Then somebody like, Jerry Goldsmith or John Williams, their sketches were like 12 and 16 stages. Everything's there. Except for the fact that, and this is when kids come to me and I look at their orchestrations, the first thing I look at is the way they divide their string in the string section. Because that whole approach to balancing the string section, you can't learn unless you've been around that. You can't learn that with computers and samples and such. And so they don't really do the divisions. They don't divide this, even the 16 scale. That sketch John Williams isn't going to divide those scripts, he expects his orchestra to know how to balance. So that's sort of the transition from paper to computer meant that as these guys the music editors, we talked about 10 tracks before, every cue is now demoed in a synthetic way before it even hits live musicians. So you're essentially doing the score twice as a composer these days. You do it once with synthesized sounds, and then once with your beat. And because of that the time factor comes in there too. There are people in the process now in between the composer and the orchestrator who actually extract those files out of the computer to get them prepared for the orchestrator to be able to do that work.
So now, and so I tried to do that whole thing, and I wrote this song, Walking on Air, actually was good for me, because it was a single and everything. But that was one time, and then Animal House was different, because they wrote it from the script. Different movies like Separate Lives were kind of a combination of things, because I met the director, and we discussed it in New York. And then it was kind of, a lot of it was written because I had this relationship with this girl person, and
that's the person.
Yeah. Who influenced the song? So anyway, and that was a Separate Life, so which was recorded by Phil Collins and Marilyn Martin.
So do you have input as to who the artist is who's going to be recording the song?
Yeah, I'd like to. We're trying to now. It's funny you mention that, because we talk about it every day. Who's going to record it? Are you going to sing it? I don't know.
But Separate Lives, did you reach out to Phil Collins?
No, I kind of knew about it, it was kind of a combination of things, But, I knew him. That's why it kind of, it was a different kind of a situation. And he had already heard about the song as far as just bits and pieces, But no, and finally when it all came together, it was, pretty amazing. It was a number one record all over the world. So.
You made several very, very successful. Now, a song that's a hit song that you've written for a film, how far in advance does the song come out? Not generally at the same time, but when Justin Timberlake, I got this feeling that came out 4 or 5 months at least before the movie came out. But in terms of when you write a song, are they giving you long lead times?
Well, he had a situation where it was a hit, it became a hit, and then the movie came out, which is like fantastic. It helps to sell the movie too.
But he wrote the song for the film, so.
Yeah. As fans. Isn't that funny? I was like, so they paid me. I was like, wow. Paid by the baseball commission. I don't even have to play baseball.
He also has the backside of that guitar signed by everyone on the set.
In the cast,
in his house.
Yeah, it's in a frame.
Very cool.
Yeah.
The broken pieces?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but I've done a lot of different things. I was just talking to Kurt last night about this, the money pit, because that was, sometimes you get in a situation like this, where I was hired to do it and for a nice bit of change. And you know, I was like, "Oh, that's good," and then the song was not all there, so I had to contribute writing it, even though I didn't get any credit. I rewrote the bridge of the Money Pit song. It's a song called
"The Heart Is So Willing."
The Heart Is So Willing. My brain, you know, it's funny because I've been having problems with my short-term memory, my long-term memory, and my short-term memory.
We know Peter Hackman said he will travel.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. You need to take him with you.
All right, great, no problem.
So J. Peter, look, in terms of, besides being a composer, you're also an amazing keyboardist. And now, you toured with huge rock bands in the 70s. Who were some of the people you performed with?
Well, I was in Phil Collins' band for 10 years. Yeah. Where I met Steve.
Yeah.
Last time I saw him was in 1985. Some place we weren't meeting. Yeah. And I played with Eric Clapton, Al Jarreau, the late great Al Jarreau, who passed away recently, bless his heart. Frank Zappa and Bowie and Al Stewart.
How do you go from, first of all, you sit at the Royal Academy in London,
yeah,
and then work with all these huge rock artists. Now, how do you go from that to being film composer?
Oh, so sir, it was luck, really, always being at the right place at the right time. I used to do sessions when I came to in Los Angeles, doing soundalikes, which is when a film wants to have a Stephen Bishop song, for example, but they can't afford it because it's so unbelievably expensive. So they get a bunch of session musicians in the studio and they record a Stephen Bishop song that sounds exactly like, And the guy who used to take these sessions became a music supervisor for a Universal TV series, which was a Miami Vice clone, I think. And because I was out with Phil Collins' band and he had the main title, he got me an interview with the head of the music at Universal as a possible composer. And it turned out I knew this guy from London. He was kind of a gangster. And I walked through the door of the tower in Universal. And he said to me, I said, "You bastard, what are you doing here?" And of course all the producers went, "Did he just call the head of music for Universal about this?" And he said, "Oh, son, how are you doing? All right. He said, "Do you think you can do this?" I said, "I have no idea." He said, "You're in." And so, yeah.
And that's how it went.
So I thought, "Hey, well, I better see if I can do this." And so I guess I could. Yes. But he's no longer with us, bless his heart, but thanks for believing in me.
And how did you get into it?
There's no short story to that. I mean, it was short. I just always loved film growing up. Film and film music collected. That's what I listened to. I had soundtracks.
Yeah.
And after graduating from school at Michigan, I needed more training before I wanted to vote myself. I needed more training. So I went to Berklee College of Music for a few years. I felt I was ready, and I came out to California. Didn't know anybody out here, drove cross country 4 days, 3 nights, couldn't wait to get out here. Then left the telephone number of someone I was going to stay with back in Detroit. So I slept in my car in Manhattan Beach. I knew he lived in Manhattan Beach, and I started walking the streets. I'm Rosecrans at Pacific, or Main, whatever that street is, or the beach. And I just walking down Rose Queens, looking at all the addresses in the mailbox, and I found him. And I stayed in his living room for about a month, and immediately got a job at a hospital, Brotman Memorial Hospital. I'd always worked in hospitals, because I was pre-med at Michigan, and dropped it all to get into music. And then took orchestration lessons with Albert Harris. You guys know Albert Harris up in the valley? And then after 6-7 months, I said, this is enough of this hospital stuff. I came out here to do music. And friends of my parents, high school teachers in Detroit, knew a guy who moved out here who was a projectionist at Tadeo on Seward. And I met this guy, and he was late. It was a night session. He was late getting there, and he got there, and it's dark out, and no one was at the studio. It was a little thing on Seward in Hollywood. But he said, I got to go out of work. And he ran up the stairs, just walk around, see if you can meet somebody. And there was, and no one was there. The lights were out in the hallway. And down at the end of the hall was music coming out of a room. And I thought, well, I might as well, here, I'm going to go down. And it ended up being a music editor by the name of Dan Carlin Jr. And he was working on a film called When You Coming Back, Red Rider. And I sort of stuck my head around the corner. And he had just moved out there to work with his father.